single honeybee weighs just a tenth of a gram. But a beehive is worth more than its weight in gold. Crops pollinated by bees are worth $215 billion worldwide, and those bees provide us with 75% of the fruits, veggies, and nuts that we eat. Their pollinating services are worth at least $24 billion to US farmers, but that's probably an underestimate. Bees also pollinate the coffee plant. That might be the most critical job on Earth. One could say that bees are the bee's knees. To say that bees are important would be like saying Beyonce is a pretty good singer. Incidentally, she has a bee impersonating fly named after her. When people talk about bee death, they're usually talking about the European honeybee. Cue the bee roll, please. This one species is basically a domesticated animal, just like cows, sheep, or chickens, taken from the wild, put in a box, and used to harvest honey and pollinate crops. Each winter, it's normal for a small fraction of colonies to die off, but between 1947 and 2005, US beekeepers lost nearly half their bees. By 2006, beekeepers were reporting losses as high as 90%, and this honeybee apocalypse was given a name: colony collapse disorder. Talk about a buzzkill.
Soon.
A hive that falls victim to CCD is like a ghost town. No adult worker bees, the honey and immature young left behind. It's pretty much just a lonely queen wandering around like her friends stranded her at the party. But honeybees' wild solo living cousins are in trouble too. It's estimated that over the past 120 years, as many as half of all wild bee species have gone extinct. Bee die-offs have been reported as far back as 1868, but as far as we know, they've never happened on this scale before, and we're not entirely sure what's causing it. Pesticides are one of the likely culprits, particularly a class of chemicals called neonicotinoids. Feeding on neonicotinated food can be deadly to bees, and even at non-lethal doses, bees can lose the ability to communicate and forage. In some places, there's just not as many flowers as there used to be. Like humans, bees do best when they eat a balanced diet from many different sources. But thanks to habitat loss, we're giving them a buffet with just a few choices, and it's definitely not all you can eat. And just because they're small doesn't mean that bees can't get sick. When a colony is weakened by pesticides or lack of food, they become more vulnerable to viruses, parasites, and all kinds of other infections, like these blood-sucking mites, which, judging from their name, I'm guessing are pretty bad. Now, these bacteria can turn larvae into liquid, and these parasites lay eggs inside the bees' breathing tubes, suffocating them to death. Turns out some bees are naturally resistant to some of these infections, though, so scientists are trying to breed entire colonies that can fight off these microscopic horrors. According to a 2015 study in the journal Science, it's likely that instead of one culprit, bee declines are being driven by a perfect storm of troubles: pesticides, habitat loss, and infections. But there are possible solutions, and all of us can do our part. We can plant more flowers in more places, reduce our use of pesticides, keep out those invasive species, and take better care of our wild bees. And most of all, we all need to keep an eye on our relationship with nature, whether it's in the garden or the grocery store. The Belgian writer Maurice Maeterlinck wrote in 1901, "You will probably more than once have seen her fluttering about the bushes in a deserted corner of your garden without realizing that you were carelessly watching the venerable ancestor to whom we probably owe most of our flowers and fruits and possibly even our civilization." As William Shakespeare once said, "To be or not to be." To be. Stay curious. Here's a riddle. Roses are red, violets are blue, flowers need bees, but bees need flowers too. These two branches on the tree of life have evolved to rely on each other so tightly, you can't have one without the other. So which came first, bees or flowers?